This is your 20-minute podcast, where we do our best to give you useful information in 20 minutes or less. Today's podcast is brought to you by Audible. Get a free audiobook download and 30-day free trial at audibletrial.com/your20-minute podcast. Over 180,000 titles to choose from for your iPhone, Android, Kindle, or MP3 player. Now, here's your host, David Brower.
Welcome back to your 20-minute podcast with David Brower, and our guest today is Dr. Laurence Peters. He's an author, an educator. He's got a BA, an MA, a PhD, a law degree. Man, you have been one busy guy.
Eternal student. I love it.
Good for you.
I love the classroom.
Good for you.
I'm either teaching or I'm learning or I'm doing both.
That's fascinating. In fact, one of the things that caught my interest on your profile, and I know we're going to talk about your book and retirement and those kinds of things, but one of the things that really caught my interest was being counsel to the Subcommittee on Select Education and Civil Rights for the U.S. House of Representatives from 1986 to 1993. I can't even imagine how interesting that was.
Oh, it was so interesting. I had a ball. I worked for a congressman from New York, Major Owens, who was the first librarian to be elected to Congress. And he had marched with Martin Luther King. He had a great record on civil rights. He's a sharecropper's son, came up the hard way from the South, and was probably the most intelligent, the most well-read person I've ever met. Incredible passion for civil rights. And with him, we were the first subcommittee to hold the first hearing on ADA, the Americans with Disabilities Act.
Right.
And, you know, it was because he saw the connection between civil rights for African-Americans and civil rights for disabled people. And it was such a natural fit. There were so many good things that came out of the experience. I was only there for 6 years, but we managed to pass a slew of legislation. We were the first subcommittee to hold a hearing on pediatric AIDS. AIDS was, you know, some horrible, stigmatizing disease
right
in the early 80s. And people thought that somehow children could not contract AIDS because it was, quote unquote, a gay disease. So we had to try to educate our Republicans as much as anything, and generally the media, into understanding and helping them to understand that AIDS was, in fact, transmitted in utero through some uses. Certain women were using needles that were basically infected. Anyway, there's a long story.
Right.
So we were very in the forefront of a lot of very progressive legislation. And I just, like, I was in my element. You know, so certain times and certain roles in life, you feel like, okay, I was born to do this, you know, kind of thing.
So, exactly, yeah.
I'll tell you, I mean, what was most remarkable is the fact that I'm originally from the UK. I don't know if you saw that on my bio.
I did, yeah.
And to be given an opportunity, let me do my patriotic thing here. As a former citizen of the UK, I'm now a citizen of the United States. To be able to be privileged to be in that position was just incredible to me. And to see the openness of the American political system and how, you know, people, I guess these days in particular, are feeling very frustrated about the American politics in general.
Right.
But I'm here to tell you that it is among the most vibrant, the most open systems we have in the entire democratic world. It can allow a person like Trump to come into whatever you think about him, and it can allow an Obama to be president. It does respond to the people. And I think that's the essence of a democracy, that it's open, it's responsive, and things happen as a result of people getting elected. Not that everybody can agree all the time with those results, but the system has a way of working. I'll just leave it at that.
It does. Generation after generation, whether you like it, love it, hate it, or anywhere in between, it has some kind of innate balance to be able to continue to go on and on.
You know, it's a very well-built machine, and it does work. And your voice can be heard. And it does make a difference. If you become politically active, you can make a difference. So I don't think that's true of every system out there. And so, you know, my sense is that we need a little pep talk sometimes about the vibrancy of the system. And I just wanted to use the opportunity you've given me to just put that plug in for the democracy.
Outstanding. Outstanding. Good. I couldn't agree more. Let's move on to your book, because I'm equally excited about this. A book called, you've co-authored it, Retirement Reading, Bibliotherapy for the Over 60s Crowd, which includes me. And there is a lot of myths out there, a lot of, I don't know, media-created impressions about what retirement means and doesn't mean. And my sense is this book really kind of zeroes in on the truth of it.
Yeah, well, yeah, I wrote it with my brother, who's back in England, and we both are in our 60s, and we both, you know, read a lot. And we thought, you know, some of the wisdom of the reading, we've read, you know, pretty much a lot of Philip Roth, you know, who back in the day was quite the author, quite the American author. We've read a lot of British authors like William Boyd and Graham Swift. You know, a lot of these authors have things to share about what it is like to grow old, and particularly in the 60s. We also refer to classic authors like Cicero and Marcus Aurelius. The long and short is not to make people into crushing bores, you know, or to just appeal just totally to bookworms.
Right.
Our thought was that the usual way people think about retirement is it's basically either a financial proposition. You know, everybody thinks about retirement in terms of, can I afford it? What will my lifestyle look like based on a reduced amount of income? That's one of the first thoughts that people have.
Right.
The second thought people have is, well, maybe because I've got this time available, I can pursue quote unquote hobbies and I can go travel.
Right.
I mean, that's usually the way people kind of look at it. As you well know, there's a lot, once you are retired, the world changes a lot for you. And there's a lot of time to fill. And you can't fill all that time on the golf course. And you can't fill all that time on traveling. This time that you're given, and it's precious time. It's time we've earned because we've worked so hard during the major part of our working careers. We deserve it. But the question always comes back, so what do we do with this time? How do we make it? How do we use it productively? And so these authors I'm going to come back to help us, I think, understand a little bit more about some of the ways in which to think about things. I mean, it's a time that's quite eventful, particularly health-wise. We're reminded of our mortality.
Yeah.
Yeah. You know, probably not once or twice, but several times. And we have to cope with that. So now, if we spend a lot of time just focused on the financial issues or the travel issues, you know, and particularly, you know, people who have, you know, basically been healthy most of their lives, when they hit 60, 65, they're going to come into some kind of health situation. It may not be serious, but it's certainly going to affect them. And we wanted to try to come up with a book that kind of helps people understand, confront that, for want of a better word, mortality issue. And what have writers said about mortality? And how have they approached it? How have you approached the fact that your body is changing quite rapidly after 60? There's quite serious, you know, issues to do with losing muscle mass. You know, I think there's a sense in which we all have to deal with that. We shrink. You know,
right.
There are physical changes that occur. You know, try to reflect on those and not kind of escape and run away from those or pretend that they don't exist and that everybody is fine and great and we're all going to live forever. It's just not, you know.
I remember a couple of generations ago, I want to say, 40, 45 years ago, and I was working at a television station, and one of the higher up management types was getting ready to retire. This was in the mid 70s. He was 65 years of age. He had worked his entire life, high energy, fast drinking, hard smoking, very wonderful family, but just a real go-getter kind of guy that was very successful. So in his mind, when he turned 65 and he retired, he was going to go home, put his feet up, hang out with his wife and the grandkids, maybe play a little golf, and he was dead within 5 years.
And it happens very often, you know. We don't know how much time.
Yeah,
we have.
Exactly.
And that's the kind of scary part too. It's a huge rite of passage, you know. We don't, you know, maybe We used to make a big fuss when people left work at 60, 65, gave them a gold watch or some other,
right.
You know, say, you know, but it's kind of sad. We no longer even perhaps, you know, make that old rite of passage a big deal anymore. The retirement party is kind of passé now.
Yep.
So how do you begin to come to terms with this new status? That's really, you know, and so I thought reading, you know, and here's a, just a plug for reading. You know, reading is a place where it has some downsides because it's not that social, but it allows you to at least reflect, help you reflect on the experience of other people who've gone through this.
One of the things I was thinking about as I read through parts or segments of your book, it seems to me, and it may be better now than when I was in school or my kids were in school, but it seems to me back in the day, as you go through junior high and high school, there should have been, in retrospect, there should have been some classes on yes. teaching you how to balance a checkbook, how to go grocery shopping, how to, you know, some real life applications. And mm-hmm. then 60 years later, it seems to me like there should be some classes on how do you retire? What are the options? What kind of, you know what I mean?
Right, right. No, I think that's the right thing. And I think maybe they will, you know, we just can't kind of, you know, these days, people are so busy with everything. I mean, the current situation is a lot of people feel that they can't retire because of the economic situation. Another segment is too afraid to retire because they feel the same, the stigma that some people feel about not working. They feel that they have to be busy and they have to keep up a certain front, social front. When you retire, you know, when you're just out there walking the dog and, you know, have plenty of time to go around the mall, it feels a little bit like you're not quite part of the society. You feel a little bit like an outsider. And so people, even the label, you know, I'm retired, is not something that people like to use very much.
Well, that's right. And I think another important part of what you're talking about, no matter where you are in life, is fear. I mean, fear yeah. is a real deal. Whether you're working, whether you have a family, whether you have retirement, there's real fear out there that you have to figure out a way to be able to face those fears to kind of get back into your own skin.
Yeah, there are fears. And so, you know, one way of dealing with them is a negative way. There's a huge increase in depression, in suicide. And all those, you know, bad things, you know, when people basically don't have work, because work has provided so much meaning their whole life. It's provided their identity.
Yep.
And so when you lose that identity, you feel like you've lost part of yourself. And you kind of have to kind of reach back down in deep to find that inner self that's sort of been there the whole time in your working life, but really hasn't been able to be expressed and to surface, just to get a sense of other people out there who are struggling. You don't feel so alone.
Right.
You feel other people have gone through this as well. And they haven't come up necessarily with great answers, with the complete answer, but they've come up with something which makes you feel like you too could figure out your own meaning, your own sense of, you know, how things stack up, how things work.
Absolutely. We've only got a couple of minutes left, Laurence, and yeah. I wanted to touch on bibliotherapy. I think that's such an important word. And okay. when you go back and talk about the Egyptians and King Ramses and how all of this kind of history helps you create this book, can you touch on that in a couple of minutes?
The first library ever in the world was the one that was founded in ancient Egypt. And over the pharaoh then, King Ramses, wrote over the first library the motto, the house of healing for the soul. And that's basically one function of books. I mean, we're used to thinking books, well, you look them up for reference purposes, you know, so on. They're a record of certain events, chronological. But the notion of books as healing, as therapy, is something we kind of lost along the way over this 2,000-year history. But the Greeks also had the same feeling about not just books, but about art itself. And we kind of lost the notion of soul along the way. You know, both the Egyptians and the Romans believed in the idea of a soul. We kind of feel, well, yes, sort of, if you're religious, But really, I think it was Spinoza who said that, you know, our basic point, purpose on earth is to refine and mature our souls, which are there from our birth and need this constant, they need to fulfill themselves. They need to begin, the passions that we had as young people need to be expressed still as older people, perhaps in a different form. So if you kind of recognize this, if you try, if you recognize your the soulfulness that's in you and in everybody, that it's about trying to express some inner meaning, inner self, then books can help you, because books can help you see how other souls have done it.
It's innate in each of us, and we need to figure out a way to pay attention, bring it to the surface, and help us live a more enjoyable life as we get older.
I would love for people to read this book and correspond with me. I'd love for them to, even we could create a virtual book club where people could talk about some of these titles. You know, just let's pick out one of these titles. I review 50 books. And let's, you know, have a conversation about it. And I'm very open to that. And that conversation is just not out there for me. It may be, you know, for other people. I'm not somehow a book clubby person. But in terms of these kinds of authors and in terms of these issues, I'm ready for a conversation.
That sounds fabulous and very important, to say the least. Folks, his website is laurencepeters.com, L-A-U-R-E-N-C. Peters.com. The book is Retirement Reading, Bibliotherapy for the Over 60s. And it's not only an important read, it's also a wonderful conversation that we just had. And I wish we had another 20 minutes. I really enjoyed it.
Well, thank you. I very much appreciate it, David. It's been very enjoyable for me, too.
Dr. Laurence Peters, who lives in Maryland now, and we thank him very much for his time and his experience. You've been listening to your 20-minute podcast with David Brower. We hope you follow us on Facebook at facebook.com/your20-minute podcast.
Until next time, don't forget to download your free audiobook at audibletrial.com/your20-minute podcast. That's audibletrial.com/your20-minute podcast for your free audiobook. And thanks for listening to your 20-minute podcast with David Brower.